Professor Dave again, let's take a few more derivatives.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Now we know how to take the derivative of polynomials, trig functions, products, quotients, and even composite functions. So let's extend our skills of differentiation to just one more class of functions, those being logarithmic and exponential functions. If you've forgotten what logarithms are, go back and check out my three-part series on this topic now. Otherwise, let's do some calculus with these functions. Rather than going through a lot of derivations, let's just highlight a handful of rules that we can count on. First, let's recall that the natural log is the logarithm with base e. As it happens, the derivative of the natural log of x is equal to 1 over x. From this, we can also know the derivative of the log of x with some base a. As we know from the change of base formula, this can be expressed as the natural log of x over the natural log of a. And this will be easy to take the derivative of, because 1 over the natural log of a is a constant. So let's pull that out. And as we said, the derivative of the natural log of x is equal to 1 over x. So putting our constant back in, we get 1 over the natural log of a times x. So let's memorize these two rules for finding the derivative of the natural log of x and the derivative of any logarithm of x with some other base. Now let's see how we can combine these definitions with the other rules we have learned. Say we want to differentiate the natural log of sine of x. This is a composite function, so we need the chain rule. First, we take the derivative of the natural log, and that gives us the reciprocal of whatever the natural log was operating on. So we get 1 over sine x. Then we multiply by the derivative of what was inside, and the derivative of sine x is cosine x. So we end up with cosine x over sine x, which is equal to cotangent x. This means that when we take the derivative of the natural log of any function, like the natural log of g of x, the answer will be the derivative of what's inside the log over what was originally inside, or g prime of x over g of x. Now, what about finding the derivative of log base 10 of x squared? Again, we need the chain rule. We know that the derivative of the log of base 10 of something will be 1 over the natural log of 10 times whatever was in the parentheses. So we get 1 over the natural log of 10 times x squared. Now we have to multiply this by the derivative of what was inside, and that will give us 2x. So we get 2x over the natural log of 10 times x squared, which simplifies to 2 over the natural log of 10 times x. This can certainly get more complicated, but our approach will always be the same, applying the chain rule in whatever manner necessary. Now let's look at exponential functions. Remember that an exponential function, rather than something like x squared, is one where the exponent is the variable. So swapping these, we have 2 to the x. How can we get the derivative of this? Well, the rule is that the derivative of some exponential function, a to the x, with base a, will be equal to the natural log of a times a to the x. So in the case of 2 to the x, we get natural log of 2 times 2 to the x. The only tricky thing here is that if the exponent is not simply x, but is rather an expression containing x, we will then have to multiply our answer by the derivative of that expression. So let's say we have 2 raised to the quantity 3x plus 1. If we take the derivative of this, just like before, we have the natural log of 2 times the original function, 2 to the quantity 3x plus 1. But now we multiply by the derivative of this exponent, which is 3, and we can then put the 3 up front. Let's point out one more thing now. We mentioned that the derivative of a to the x is the natural log of a times a to the x. So what if we take the derivative of e to the x? That would give us the natural log of e times e to the x. But the natural log of e represents the power that e must be raised to in order to get e. And that power is 1. So the natural log of e is equal to 1, and we are left with simply e to the x. That's right, the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. Rather than simply marvel at this fact, let's look at a fun way to prove that this is true. When we learned about series, we found an interesting way to represent e by using factorials. If we want to represent the function e to the x in the same way, we can just tweak this series a little bit, putting in the necessary x terms so that we get 1 plus x squared over 2 factorial plus x cubed over 3 factorial all the way down the line. So we can say that this series is equal to e to the x. Now let's see what happens when we take the derivative of this entire series, just using the simple power rule that we know. The derivative of 1 is 0, so that goes away. The derivative of x is 1. The derivative of x squared is 2x. And 2 factorial is 2 times 1, so the 2's cancel and we get x. The derivative of x cubed is 3x squared, and 3 factorial is 3 times 2 times 1. So the 3's cancel and we get x squared over 2 times 1, which is 2 factorial. For x to the 4th, again we get 4x cubed, the 4's cancel, and we are left with x cubed over 3 factorial. Amazingly, this will continue all the way to infinity, and as we will notice, the series ends up completely unchanged. So this is one way of proving that the derivative of e to the x is simply e to the x. There are many other elegant ways to rationalize this fact, but all we need to know for now is that this function is equal to its derivative, which means that they will be exactly the same on a graph. If f and f prime are the same graphically, this means that every point on the function is equal to its own slope at that point. This fascinating truth will come back when we learn about integration, but for now, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.